Sci-Fi for Me is about to take you on an incredible journey into the realms of science fiction, fantasy, and horror. Interviews with writers, filmmakers, artists, and actors. Conventions and fandom. Previews and reviews of movies and television. Sci-Fi for Me is working to be the most popular science fiction magazine in the solar system. Subscribe now and enter the fantastic world of Sci-Fi for Me, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
All right, stand by for the week's news from the frozen-ish tundra of the Midwest. Good morning, Multiverse.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009. Live from our studios in Kansas City, this is sci-fi4me.tv.
I know we say our studio's in Kansas City, and it actually is, but, you know, it is what it is. We do okay here. Welcome, everybody. Thanks for being here. I see Keely and Dave in the chat already. We are broadcasting live to YouTube, Facebook, and Odyssey with the week's headlines in science fiction, fantasy, and horror. We got some video game news coming up, some comic book news, and some indie comics, some crowdfunding updates, along with horror news and the weather and some event updates. And we're going to get to that here in just a moment. First of all, I would like to take a moment to thank everybody for showing up, whether you are here with us live or if you're watching on tape delay. We do appreciate you being here. And we invite you to subscribe if you haven't already. Find us over on various different video platforms as well as a lot of social media. And here we go. We're going to start with events as we usually do. And Mrs. Boss is in here to, let me turn that camera on, to talk out what we've added to our list, because we've added to the list this week.
We have added to the list, and we keep adding because I've got more that I need to add. So I'm not complaining.
Well, that's good, because I don't know that I'd listen to you complain.
Oh, I see how it is. I have to, but you don't have to.
Sure, exactly. That's rank doth have its privileges.
That couch is looking pretty comfy, isn't it?
Dave says it's not a good Saturday without my good morning multiverse. Well, I appreciate that. Thank you very much, Dave. All right, so what do we have this morning?
So this week we have Long Island Comic Fest in Hicksville, New York. Rodcon, Cedar Falls, Iowa. Mid-State Comic-Con, Harrington, Delaware. RaiderCon in Moica, Illinois. Now, we've got several Quad City Cons in Des Moines, Omaha, St. Charles, Madison, Springfield, Illinois, Wisconsin Dells, and Fort Dodge, Iowa. We have Fanboy Expo in Las Vegas, Nevada. Bangor Comic and Toy Con, Bangor, Maine. AccaCon, Logan, Queensland, Australia, and Timmins MiniCon in Timmins, Ontario, Canada. So this week, it takes our total up to 2,348. And I believe this last weekend when I was doing this, we did the show and it was, what, 2,332? And by, what, 5 hours after the show was done, I was already in the 40s. So as you can see, they're kind of rolling in. And what helps is the fact that the world is opening up and people are doing conventions again. And I'm seeing a lot of talk online. Hey, we're starting a new convention. We're starting a new convention, which is great. And I'm happy that we're able to put these new conventions on our list to give them the exposure on, you know, for everybody to find, because we do have the list. We do have that calendar that every weekend you can sit and see what's going on if you happen to be in town or traveling. And, you know, it's good exposure for them, and we want to help all of them out regardless of the size. And it doesn't matter, you know, if they are held in the back room in a library or in one of these big convention halls. And on that note, If you do know of a convention or you're putting one on yourself, let us know so that we can add it to our list and calendar. Send us an email at events@scififorme.com or find us on one of the many platforms that we are on with social media. You know, through Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, you name it, we're there. Let us know so that we can make sure that it is added to our list and this can just keep growing. Because we take pride in the fact that it is one of the largest, most comprehensive and active lists on the net.
Now, just to make a note, we're not on TikTok.
We are not on TikTok or Snapchat.
nor will we be. All right. So, okay. So, yes, that list, library events, big convention halls, everything in between. If you've got a regular thing that happens in your comic book shop that counts as a Comic-Con, that counts. So any of that. And Minnie does yeoman's work maintaining that list and the calendar, making sure that that goes. And it's a rolling thing, too. I mean, you're dealing with, especially on the COVID side of things, dealing with changes in policy all the time and that kind of thing. Do you have any recommendations, let's say, for people who are building out their brand new website for their brand new Comic-Con?
Put the dates in there where they're kind of front and center, because I have found that there are times where I need to look like I'm purchasing either tickets or having to book the hotel itself, and I'm getting dates off a hotel website versus the convention website. That is, I mean, if I have to go searching for it, and you got, you know, I'm going to keep searching because I have my job here making sure that our stuff is up to date. However, if you have someone who might be coming into town and looking at going to a convention, if they're going to have to search like I have to search sometimes, are they going to want to continue on? Yeah. If the website's not organized, then what's that say about the convention itself?
All right. Words to live by. Thank you very much, Mrs. Boss.
You're welcome.
And we do have our list of, speaking of the COVID, a list of a few different changes in schedules and policies, actually. Well, let's start with the cancellations. We've got Nullus, Anxietas. This is a Discworld convention down in Sydney, New South Wales, Australia. It is canceled. That's the one that we have this week. And then we have some updates on masking and vaccination policies. Dark Side of the Con in Parsippany, New Jersey. They are requiring masks for anyone who is unvaccinated. Indiana Comic Convention in Indianapolis requiring masks all the way around. And then we have the vaccine policies, the vaccination policies. And these are changing all the time, some week to week. So you're going to see some stuff on here that we saw last week, and things continue to change. Costume Con in Bethesda, Maryland. Now they are requiring proof of vaccination, or if you have an exemption from the vaccine, they'll take a negative test, and everybody's required to wear a mask. Earpapalooza, they will take a proof of vaccine. If you have an exemption, they want you to apply 4 weeks out to see if they'll accept it. If they do accept it, then they want a negative test prior to your arrival to the event. Plus, everybody's got to wear a mask. It's getting complicated. People are trying to figure out all of the different ways that they've got to do this. WonderCon in Anaheim, vaccination proof or negative test plus the masks. Luxcon, Eurocon in Dudelange, Luxembourg. Proof of vaccination or a negative test or proof of recovery. They are currently under the 2G protocol for Europe. Heliosphere in Tarrytown, New York, vaccinations plus masks. Sac Con in Sacramento. This is one of the ones that updated from last week. They are now saying they'll take proof of vaccination or a negative test, and everybody's negative test and a mask. BabsCon in Burlingame, California, proof of vaccination and masks. And that's the same for Colorado Anime Fest in Denver. And then we have EasterCon in Birmingham, UK. They will take a proof of vaccination or a medical exemption. I spelled that wrong. A medical exemption and the paperwork you can find on the NHS site for that. Masks all around. Minicon in Minneapolis, fully vaccinated per CDC guidelines. So whatever the CDC says counts as the definition of vaccinated at the time of the event, that's what they're going with. Anime St. Louis, proof of vaccination or a negative test. Jordan Con in Atlanta, vaccination or a negative test from a medical provider. I've got some spelling errors this morning. My apologies. German Comic Con in Spring in Dortmund, Germany. Same 2G protocol. They're looking at proof of vaccination or recoveries and masks for everyone. Now, we have a new card to add to our list. This is the No More Restrictions card. These are updates where they're sitting there saying, we're not requiring any particular thing because of whatever reasons, whether it's state policy or CDC guidelines or whatever. Made in Asia in Brussels, Awesome Con in Washington, D.C., Arizona Game Fair in Mesa, the Vax event in Ghent, Belgium. All of these are, masks are not required, but they are requested and suggested. No proof of vaccination, no negative tests or anything like that. They do ask that you be responsible and take care of yourself accordingly. They're, of course, making recommendations that you mask up and have your vaccines, but they are no longer requiring any of that to attend to those events, which is kind of a sign that things are going somewhat back to normal, and I imagine we'll get a lot more of those events that start to relax their policies and their restrictions as we get further into 2022. But we'll keep an eye on it. As things change, we will update accordingly, and we will let you know. Now, for those of you who are planning to travel to a city hosting an event, we have the weather forecast.
Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
My microphone is off. Thank you. Sorry. I hit the button. All right. That's my one mistake for this morning, if anybody's counting. Hush.
I heard that.
All right. Thank you, everybody. It should. Are we good now? Hopefully everything's on, right? All right. Let's try this again. Different creative award shows this week. Art Directors Guild, the Costume Designers Guild, and the Visual Effects Society. For the Art Directors Guild, we have several winners in genre. Dune winning for fantasy feature film. WandaVision for TV movie or limited series. Loki for 1 hour period or fantasy single camera series. Squid Game for 1 hour contemporary single camera series. And What We Do in the Shadows, half hour single camera series. Costume Designers Guild handing out awards to Dune for excellence in sci-fi fantasy film. And The Book of Boba Fett for excellence in sci-fi fantasy television. That's Shauna Terpsich. We had her as a guest on the Ranker Pit a while back. The Visual Effects Society has a number of different awards going out. Several for Dune, some for Foundation, The Witcher, Spider-Man No Way Home, Loki. So all of those going out. Outstanding Visual Effects in a Feature. Outstanding Effects, Simulations, and Photoreal Feature. Foundation winning for Sustained Effects, Simulations in an Episode, Commercial, or Real-Time Project. So congratulations to all of those winners. And we have here, passing along, Asimov's Science Fiction Magazine has announced the finalists for their 36th Annual Readers Awards. They've posted the list of titles along with links to online copies so you can read them for yourself, and we will link to that in the notes. These stories all appeared in the pages of Asimov's. The winners will be announced later this year. And passing along this call for submissions from the writers, for any of you who are writers, pulp magazine Broadswords and Blasters is looking for sword and planet stories. So think John Carter and Flash Gordon type of thing. This is for a one-shot anthology. Your story submissions need to be between 5 and 10,000 words, self-contained, no serialized cliffhangers or anything like that. If your story is selected, you'll get a flat $40 plus an electronic copy of the book. Submissions will close July 15th. The plan is for the book to be available in time for Christmas 2022. We've got a link to that in our notes if you want more details. And the publisher Zombies Need Brains. This is a publisher that crowdfunds multiple anthologies at a time. They've been fully funded for their latest collection, three anthologies. Noir, edited by David B. Coe and John Zacher. Shattering the Glass Slipper, edited by Rondi Salsitz and Crystal Sarakis. And Brave New Worlds, edited by S.C. Butler and Joshua Palmateer. About 14 stories each, with the possibility of additional fourth anthology if the stretch goals are reached. This is funding over on Kickstarter. Every project includes work from established authors as well as newcomers. The target date for release on this is August. And over on Publishers Marketplace, we've got an announcement for another deal. J.R. Dawson. This is a debut novel, The First Bright Thing. Post-World War II, three magically gifted women run a circus for sparks. That's what they call people with sudden and unexpected abilities, like themselves. And with another war on the horizon, there's a darker circus that's threatening to overpower everything. If their leader is not defeated, things could go bad. This is setting up at Tor in a two-book deal. First book will be out in summer of 2023. And available this week from Theogony Books, part of Chris Kennedy Publishing, Seed in the Sky. This is the third This Fine Crew story by Mike Jack Stumbos. Just as the Interstellar Initiative is starting to figure out how to get along, humanity's first interstellar sin comes back to haunt them. What appears to be a new star in the sky is actually something else, and it's ready to destroy the planet Earth if the initiative doesn't figure out how to communicate with it or stop it. The fate of humanity could rest with four cadets. Bum, bum, bum. Also from Chris Kennedy this week, we've got a cover reveal for Diplomacy, the fifth book in the Abner Fortas series by Paul Allen Platt. Coming April 8th. maybe sooner. Piat, not Platt. Sorry about that. All right. Over on to the fantasy-ish side, we've got a couple of Thousand Steps into the Night by Tracy Chi. This is from Clarion Books. This came out on March 1st. Serving girl Miyuko, the kind of girl most people wouldn't give a second thought to, after she's cursed by a demon and cast out of her village, she sets off on a journey across the land of Awara to save her soul. And that's out now. And then we have over here from Marvel tie-ins, we've got Okoye to the People, a Black Panther novel by Ibi Zoboi. This is from Marvel Press. This is out on the 22nd of this month. Okoye gets her origin story in a new novel. It's set at the start of her training with the Dora Milaje. She's set on a mission to accompany King T'Chaka to New York to visit a humanitarian organization with a long, sinister shadow, and she uncovers a plot to flood drugs into the area, targeting mostly poor people of color in the residence. She must bring her Wakandan sensibilities and skills to Brooklyn to save the king's reputation and the innocent people being harmed by capitalistic greed. That's the that's the description there. Then we have this note. Actor Ben McKenzie, you know him from Gotham and the OC. New Republic journalist Jacob Silverman, they have paired up for a book called Easy Money, setting up at Abrams Press. The book is an account of the author's ongoing investigation into the world of cryptocurrency and the people impacted by its spectacular rise and potential impending fall. McKenzie said this is about two things, money and lying. He says, I know a little about the former from my econ degree, the latter that fascinates me. Maybe that's why I do it for a living. McKinney was represented here by Noah Ballard for the deal. The book is slated for summer of 2023. So a little bit of nonfiction from one of our known actors. Gizmodo on Wednesday posted a first look at Soul of the Deep from Natasha Bowen. This is the sequel to Skin of the Sea. It combines mermaids and West African folklore. The main character from the first book, Simadeli, is back, facing some new challenges after she traded away everything to save those people closest to her. Now, as she's watching over the land of the dead from the ocean floor, signs of demons start to appear, and it's because of Simi and the deal that she made. The fate of the world now rests on her having to break her promise and team up with a trickster god. This is from Random House. It'll be available for pre-order now. It's on shelves September 27th. And this is getting some chatter over on the socials. Over on his Not a Blog site, George R.R. Martin has dished out a few new updates, including the one everybody kind of maybe still cares about. He says he is still writing The Winds of Winter, and he gives us an update on a few other projects, specifically the second volume of Archmaster Gildane's history, which began with Fire and Blood, getting a condensed illustrated edition. More Duncan Egg novellas are on the list, especially now that there's a TV series in the works, and it looks like that series may be called A Knight of the Seven Kingdoms, and will adapt the first Dunk and Egg novella, The Hedge Knight. Martin says he's also got a new coffee table book in the works and a who's who of Westeros, plus various television shows, of course. And he says he's involved a lot in those. He's very pleased with what he's seen so far of House of the Dragon. There are more shows in development, things of which he's not allowed to share yet, but he does reassure his fans that he is working on The Winds of Winter, he says. I don't know. Tim Harvey, do you believe him?
I believe he's working on it.
You ever think he's going to finish?
That is debatable. That's
the question, right? tell you what. It's
you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the sad thing is that when it comes out, if it comes out, say it does come out,
yeah,
there's going to be folks who aren't going to be satisfied with it. I mean, the anticipation has built up so much that no matter what he puts out, no matter how good it is, there will be folks who are unsatisfied, and that's the way of the world.
I also wonder how much the delay is going to impact people who just decide they just don't care anymore. They're not even going to buy the book.
You know, there's going to be that percentage too. And the fact is that sometimes there's just burnout on series for fans and creators. For all we know, it is the least exciting thing for Martin himself to have on his plate. He could be, you know, and that makes that could make it harder for him to finish it too. Yeah. So
I know. Well, speaking of burnout and having your soul sucked out of you, what have you got for us this week?
Well, we'll try not to have too much loss of soul as we go with this today, but we have a little bit of news. There was a little bit of a debate recently about whether or not Halloween Ends had actually finished production. There have been some conflicting reports, but it has, in fact, according to the producer, Ryan Turek, has actually wrapped production. And this is not wrapping post-production. There's still the post-production work to do. And of course, it is scheduled to come out this October 14th, right? Of course, before Halloween itself. This is the official word. And there you go. Now you know. And interestingly enough, we got a tiny bit more news about the new Predator film, Prey, a little bit more confirmation of what the actual time and place of the story. Now, we heard it was a historical film dealing with First Nations heroine, but it actually, according to the Steve Ashbell, the president of 20th Century Studios, the Hulu film is set in 1719, and it's going to take place on the Great Plains. Now, for those of us living in the Midwest, we're familiar with that geography a little bit, again, this is a film that's got a lot of folks excited, and of course going back to the more stripped down man versus alien, or in this case woman versus alien storyline. And again, we're looking at a definite return to more, you know, less flashy style for this, which I think is going to be a benefit. And Evil Dead Rise has a picture lock. Lee Cronin has put out this little bit through social media. That means that the post-production is almost over, folks. They have figured out what the movie is going to look like. Everything else is just fine-tuning at this point. They spent six months working on the edit. And they've got to do music composition, sound design at this point. But as far as how the film is going to look, what the cut of the movie is, this is what they are going for. And surprising news coming out that not only are we getting an Alien TV series, we're getting another Alien movie. It's not coming from Ridley Scott, although he is involved. Fede Alvarez is actually going to be the new writer and director for this new Alien film. Of course, we've had Alien films from Ridley Scott, and with various degrees of reception. And so this should be interesting. Now, of course, as exciting as that may be, we also have Fede Alvarez being partially responsible for the divisive Texas Chainsaw Massacre sequel. So we will have to see what happens. We don't have an actual date on when this might come out. The TV series, of course, is still planned for 2023. We'll have to see what happens here. But Steve Asbell says that Fede Alvarez's story pitch involves a really good story with a bunch of characters you haven't seen before. All right. Well, keep our eyes open on this one. And Christina Ricci, of course, returning to horror with her film Monstrous. Screen Media has acquired the North American rights, and the film is intended to release in theaters and on demand on May 13th of this year. So something to look forward to there. Nice little interesting image here. Interestingly enough, the Chicken Soup for the Soul Entertainment Company is behind this, which if you're old enough to remember when those books first rolled out, somehow Chicken Soup for the Soul, horror movies, don't necessarily see those going together. But anyway, in this particular film, Christina Ricci plays a character named Laura, who is traumatized by an abusive relationship and escapes with her 7-year-old son, Cody. Unfortunately, where they the place they have fled to, which they think is safe, clearly is not. And a bit of surprising news, we're getting a sequel to I Am Legend with Will Smith. Now, if you've seen the Will Smith I Am Legend, you are aware that Will Smith didn't exactly make it out of that film alive. Well, not in the theatrical release ending. The alternate ending that, of course, folks found on the digital and DVD releases showed him surviving. So we'll have to see how he is incorporated into the story. Now, it also stars Michael B. Jordan, who's also producing the film. Keeba Goldsmith is returning to write it. He wrote this particular version of I Am Legend, not, of course, the first adaptation of Richard Matheson's novel. But we'll have to see whether Will Smith returns in a way that makes sense. And we reported a couple weeks ago now that Eddie Izzard is going to be starring in the new Dr. Jekyll film, Hammer Films. Or Hammer Studios has now joined that project. They are going to be releasing the film. They got the UK rights. I think they're going to be involved with some production here as well. The film is currently shooting, but it's really, really nice to see Hammer back. They've been around making films again or producing films again for a little while now, but getting a lot more prominent pictures here in the last decade or so. And the folks over at, Bloody Disgusting's Screambox have got the new Pennywise, the Story of It documentary coming. This is actually going to be coming out, this summer. It premiered at this Sitges International Fantastic Film Festival in Spain last fall, and had its UK Fright Fest premiere in October, but you will be able to watch it if you go on to Streambox. And if, again, sometime this summer, don't see an actual date for this yet, but certainly something to look forward to. Now, this is not just looking at the recent films, but the book, the TV series, this Pennywise in general, the story of it, is definitely one of the more iconic villains of horror, certainly, of the last few decades. So certainly the fan reaction to every incarnation of this character has certainly been very, very positive. However, the quality of certain sequels, but anyway. And we know that Teen Wolf is getting an adaptation or moving from the TV space into the film space as the sequel is being prepared for the TV series in the form of a feature for Paramount Plus. We do know that certain cast members are not returning. There's several actually who are not currently returning for the film. Now, Dylan O'Brien, who played Styles in the film, in the TV series, of course, a very critical part of the series, is one of those actors not returning. And he recently spoke about it. And basically his reasons for returning is ultimately, and I quote here, "Ultimately, I just decided it was left in a really good place for me and I still want to leave it there. I wish them well, and I'm gonna watch it the first night it comes out. I hope it effing kicks ass, but I'm not going to be in it." And that's fair. Quite honestly, is for all of these projects where original casts are returning for new versions of things, everyone is going to have a different reaction. Everyone is involved is going to be at a different place in their life. And while it's a disappointment to fans, these guys have to do what's right for them, right? And that's just fair. And of course, more Munsters news. Exciting Munsters news for a lot of horror fans, because Cassandra Peterson, Elvira herself, has joined the cast of The Munsters. She's playing Barbara Carr, the number one real estate agent in all of Mockingbird Heights. So there'll be more news. Of course, it's Rob Zombie putting stuff out about The Munsters. There's always going to be more news. And if you are a fan of 2015's Wormwood, Road of the Dead, it is getting a sequel coming to Blu-ray in May. It's Wormwood Apocalypse. It's been acquired for distribution in the States by XYZ Films. And May 17th, 2022, the sequel is coming to Blu-ray. If you are not familiar with the series, basically, it is a zombie apocalypse series set in Australia. I think a little bit of Mad Max. I have not seen the first one. I'm actually kind of going to have to go check this out now. And while we have recently heard that Good Omens Season 2 has wrapped, there's already talk about a Season 3. A fan saying, okay, now we need Season 3. And Neil Gaiman saying, I agree. And people asked what they could do, and Gaiman said, get as many human beings as you can around the planet to watch Season 2 when it's released, and rewatch Season 1 until then. So we will have to see. Now, Season 2, it continues the story based on the novel by Terry Pratchett and Neil Gaiman, and the Season 2 story is based on the story ideas they had for a sequel to the book. Season 3, I would imagine, would be picking up something entirely new, unless we haven't just heard about Good Omens 3 that they maybe plan to write. We'll have to see. And for fans of foreign horror, we have a little show here on this very channel about that. You should check it out. Stars has commissioned its first German language series. This is a 6-part adaptation of the German graphic novel by Frank Schmulke called Night in Paradise. Now, the premise here is a taxi driver named Vincent, who's estranged from his 18-year-old daughter, and an apocalyptic event, probably zombie-related, or possibly zombie-related. I have not read the graphic novel, and the description isn't entirely clear on that. But basically, the events of the night cause the two to have to deal with each other. In the midst of all of the chaos, their own old wounds reemerge. Drama in the midst of the apocalypse. Now, the president of Stars International, Superna Kaley, said, Night in Paradise is a dark, edgy, unique project that we know will resonate with our audiences. It is the first production from Germany's Windlight Pictures, a subsidiary of ITV Studios. We'll have to take a look at that, see what comes there. It might be something for our foreign body show. And your mileage may vary on this one. We're getting another Walking Dead spinoff, this time with Maggie and Negan traveling to the Big Apple. What happened to New York in the zombie apocalypse? We have not been there yet in the Walking Dead TV show, but that's where they're headed. Now, of course, the mileage may vary part comes from the fact that Maggie, we're not going to make Maggie happen. Maggie and Negan have had a lot of interaction this recent series of The Walking Dead, causing some fans to suspect some sort of very debatable relationship developing between the two of them. This will not reassure those fans, but it has also been a very interesting series for the conflict between the two of them. Of course, Negan very responsible for killing Maggie's husband. So, in a very divisive moment of The Walking Dead. So we'll have to see what happens. It is one of many spinoffs we are now getting from the Walking Dead universe, with the original show coming to an end with this three-part final season. Lots of spinoffs. Now, we'll just have to see what happens with that. And while we still don't actually know, it's really Werewolf by Night. Everyone seems to think it's Werewolf by Night. We do have news about who's directing the new Disney Plus Halloween special. Interestingly enough, it is someone you might have heard recently. It's the Batman composer, Michael Giacchino. And your mileage may vary on the Batman soundtrack. Mr. Hunt and I had some opinions about that. You can find that on our H2O episode where we discussed the Batman. And but we'll have to see what happens. Don't know a whole lot about, again, we still don't have confirmation that it's Werewolf by Night, but everyone seems to think it is. Gael Garcia Bernal and Laura Donnelly are starring in it. And eventually we will have some sort of plot details, right? Surely we will. And if you were excited about the remake of Dead Space, of course, the iconic space horror nightmare fuel game, it was supposed to come out this fall. It's got pushed back. These things happen. It got pushed back to 2023. They're looking for an early release next year. But according to the internal documents that VentureBeat got a chance to look at, apparently it's really impressing the folks internally. Now, of course, you'd expect them to say that, but it's entirely possible that it's true. And certainly these are the folks who, you know, really are aiming to get the level of the Resident Evil 2 remake from Capcom. And that's kind of been their goal. So if we can do that, a lot of fans will be very satisfied. Of course, it's a very popular series that also didn't quite come to an end. So maybe this remake will actually get fans a real conclusion to the series. We'll see. And more cool toy news coming out for Trick or Treat Studios. They've been releasing all these great little toys. Many of them still in production phase, not actually available to get. But they've got new Toxic Avengers 5-inch figures. They've got a 50-inch Pennywise. Do you need a 50? If you give that to a child, is that wrong? I don't know, it's just awfully large and really impressive. You know, that's a very good likeness there. And new Children of the Corn 3¾-inch figures. These are not the only things they put out. Of course, we discussed several things over the last couple of episodes here, but you can head to the Trick or Treat Studio site and see more. They've got videos up and some photos of the individual pieces, but now, pretty impressive run of great horror figures if you're a fan. And if you're a fan of Ghostbusters, this is interesting. Hastel Toy has got a limited edition handmade figure version of the library lady from the Ghostbusters films. So the library goes, this is the human version, of course, before she gets all monster ghost thing. Hastel Toy, Tony Taylor Toys. It is a hand-sculpted, hand-painted, available for pre-order. This could be gone by the time we're broadcasting this. 40 pieces are available. $84 each. Not ridiculously priced, but definitely very low number, so they could already be gone. I didn't see anything this morning that said that they were, but it's entirely possible. And we've seen a lot of horror-themed clothing popping up. And Hot Topic has got a new Warner Brothers horror series of pieces of attire. Nightmare on Elm Street, Friday the 13th, Beetlejuice. All very popular line of clothing and, of course, films. But We've got swimsuits, we've got jeans, we've got dresses, we've got all kinds of things. Of course, Freddy Krueger, Jason Voorhees, and Beetlejuice all making appearances on the close. And right now, apparently they're on sale for 20% off if you have a coupon code. So there you go. And you can also wear on your feet a little bit of Halloween. Fun.com and HalloweenCostumes.com have teamed up to bring a couple of different pairs of Halloween shoes. They're high top and low top Michael Myers shoes, of course. I'm a high top sneaker guy, but I have never felt compelled to wear movie stuff on my feet. I don't know. Up to you guys. But they're out there in the world. And this is kind of fun. For fans of Godzilla, the Godzilla Final War's original concept design by Yasushi Narasawa was not the one they used for the film. This was his original design. It was a much creepier version than they went for than with Final Wars. But the maquette was found, and there is now a really limited number of statues that you can get. Now it's 39,000 yen, which translates to about $330. So I'm not entirely sure what the real price here is, but that's the rate it seems to be. That you can find this you can find this over at Tees Facto, which is, and give you guys the website here if you want to check this out, tsfacto.ne.jp. There's a lot of fantastic Godzilla statues over there to check out. And it's pretty impressive. But they went with a much more of the Destroy All Monsters style of character. This is a little dark for that particular film. And Zombie Shark, not a movie, not an Asylum picture, and not really a zombie shark, but we have an urban explorer. Juju Urbex was actually found a abandoned aquarium in Spain. Among the displays was this shark, who is small, relatively, and apparently had died before the place was abandoned and left. There a lot of the exhibits had emptied out, but this one was left behind and preserved enough to look like what you would think a zombie shark looks like. So there's a little bit of real life nightmare fuel for you. And of course, urban explorers find all sorts of interesting things, but for whatever reason, they left this shark behind. Things you find when you go exploring in the world. And that's what I got for you guys this morning. We appreciate you watching.
When you told me that your last story was the zombie shark, I mentioned Sharkula, which was the trailer that we got this week, but I didn't realize that you were actually talking about a real zombie shark. Okay. Did not have
luckily
that
it wasn't luckily it wasn't moving. It didn't attack or anything like that. Because what happens if a zombie shark bites you? What do you turn into?
Right?
I mean, if you're just trying to do a zombie, doesn't that feel like a bit of a letdown? You're gonna get bit by a zombie shark. Shouldn't there be some shark stuff that goes with that? I don't know.
Another row of teeth, maybe. Make it more efficient to eat brains. Two rows of teeth.
I guess.
All right. Thank you, sir. And we will be back with more right after this. Stand by.
You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, your portal to the science fiction multiverse.
And
I did read a fun review where someone was like, you know, I consider this film is, it's all in her head. And they put forth their reasons why none of this is actually happening. Because she runs around the film a lot, covered in blood, and nobody reacts.
I know! I know!
Foreign Bodies, Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
Did that. All right. Hit one button too many. All right. Sorry about that. Here we go with more news launching just this week over on Indiegogo. Gemshock number one from Stuntman Comics, written by Mandy Summers, based on a concept from Summers and artist Dale Keown, who's doing the cover that you see here. Interior art by Fernando Damasio, colors by Farah Nirmalisa. The story is a throwback to the 90s action comics. College co-ed Mackenzie Ferreira is chosen by the relic known as the Zero Stone to become the superheroine Gemshock in a world where villains outnumber the heroes, and the main villain, Sever, is hunting down heroes who refuse to bow to his leadership. We'll link to the campaign so you can check it out for yourself. And also, we've got an update on a project we told you about back in December. This is from Dojo-kun Comics, Toro Tales number one. Brian Marard posting that the book is 100% complete. So writing, artwork, everything is done. All that's left is printing, plus whatever add-ons they've got and stretch goals left to fulfill. The campaign has about 15 days left. And they are a third of the way through their goal. But the work on the book is finished. That is an accomplishment for some going along this far into the campaign, this early into the campaign. They don't have everything finished, but this one does. So congratulations to them on that, and we, of course, we'll link to that project as well. DC Comics has announced their first group of young creators in their new Milestone Initiative Talent Development Program. The program is part of the revival of the Milestone imprint, founded by Dwayne McDuffie, Dennis Cohen, Michael Davis, and Derek Tingle, to tell stories for Black and diverse superheroes. Static came out of this brand, as did Icon and Rocket. The Milestone Initiative is about giving a spotlight on Black and diverse creators. The inaugural class of 24 writers and artists will go through 10 weeks of virtual workshops, a one-week in-person summit, ongoing mentorship, and this is all in partnership with the Kubert School and Milestone Media. We'll post a link so you can see the full roster of the new creators in the class, get more information on the initiative if you are interested in applying. And even as the country is kind of opening back up, winding down from the lockdowns, the effects are still being felt. Warner Brothers shuffling around dates for their films again. Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom, moving from December 16th of 2022, now will be March 17th. Is that right? March 17th, 2022? That's like in 5 days. 23. Okay. March 17th, 2023. The Flash is moving from November 4th to June 23rd, 2023. Both of these COVID-related production delays with the visual effects. Hang on just a moment here. Boom, done. All right, I got rid of the bot. Black Adam is moving from July 29th to October 21st of this year, and DC League of Super Pets moving from May 20th to July 29th. taking Black Adam's place. The only movie moving forward is Shazam, Fury of the Gods. It's coming from June 2nd, 2023. Now will be December 12th of 2022. So, just in time for the holidays, we get more Captain Marvel. I will die on that hill. If you're wondering where part two of Young Justice Phantoms is on the air, producer Greg Reisman says this month it's coming. He also says he knows the date, but it hasn't been officially announced yet, so he's not allowed to say. In the meantime, we will await word as to whether or not we get a season five. Hard to believe it's gone that long already now. Season five. You remember when we didn't even know if we were ever going to get Young Justice again? Casting news for Blue Beetle, which, in case you missed it, is now going to theaters instead of straight to HBO Max. Its scheduled release date right now, August 18th, 2023. Deadline reports the project is talking with Harvey Guillen for a role. It's a role with undisclosed details, of course. You may know Guillen from What We Do in the Shadows over on FX. And Gotham Knights has at least the beginnings of a cast. Fallon Smith and Tyler DeChiara, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, they've been set as series regulars. This is the first casting announcement we got this week. This is the one-hour drama taking place after Bruce Wayne's murder. Smith will play Harper Rowe, streetwise, acerbic, often underestimated, blue-haired, bisexual, gifted engineer who can fix anything. DeCharia will play the brother, Cullen Rowe, transgender teen, tired of hiding his true self from abusive parent and tired of being polite and agreeable, clever and adept at reading human nature. Also added to the cast, we've got three others. Let's see here. Olivia Rose Keegan, Navia Robinson, and Oscar Morgan. Keegan will play Duella, who's abrasive, unpredictable, a little unhinged, but a survivor, born in Arkham Asylum, abandoned by her father, the most dangerous man in Gotham. She's turned herself into a brutal fighter and a skilled thief. Now, this could possibly be Duella Dent, also known as the Joker's daughter. Robinson will play Carrie Kelly. Yes, Carrie Kelly from The Dark Knight Returns. Fearless, idealistic, plucky, talked her way into being Batman's unlikely sidekick, first to rush in when someone needs help, and not a ginger. Morgan will play Turner Hayes. His parents were murdered. He's determined to live up to his billionaire adoptive father's name. Even though he's charming and soulful, he's never felt comfortable in the world of wealth and privilege. This is coming from Natalie Abrams, James Stottero, and Chad Fiveash will be writing. Danny Cannon will direct and executive produce the pilot. This is not, as it's been announced, this is not a spinoff of Batwoman. And 2 days after HBO Max reported that, 2 days after HBO Max announced it had shelved the Gotham Police prequel. So another chance for Gotham Central, not going to happen. But we do have this. They've officially ordered a spinoff starring Colin Farrell as the Penguin. We've heard rumors about this. We heard it was coming, but now it's official. No current plot details are available yet. It's a limited series. The drama will expand the world that Matt Reeves has created. Both Farrell and Reeves will executive produce, along with Dylan Clark and writer-showrunner Lauren LeFranc. And we've got a new figure, a new Batman, a new Superman figure. He's wearing black. It's easy mistake to make. This is from Kyoto. It's officially called the New 52 Amazing Yamaguchi Revolt Tech number 027EX Superman. This is exclusive to the Big Bad Toy Store. And it's 7 inches tall. It's based on the New 52 design. Black suit, swappable heads and hands. scheduled to arrive in June. It's available for pre-order now. Just over $100 US. Oh, and by the way, on Gotham Knights, we do also have a start date. They posted over on their Instagram, October 25th will be the beginnings of that. And Funko wants to make peace. James Gunn posting on Instagram. Funko also posting these. New Peacemaker Funko Pops. These are now available for pre-order. Available soon, they say. The set includes Eagly, Vigilante, Judo Master, an Eagle Hug, and Tidy Whitey Peacemaster. And I see Tom in the chat. The what now? Let me see. I'm assuming you're talking about the figure. The new 52 Amazing Yamaguchi Revolt Tech number 027 EX Superman. That's what that's called. This is from Kyoto. Making the figure. The new Looney Tunes live action animated hybrid starring John Cena. It's called Coyote versus Acme. Adding to the cast, Will Forte and Lana Condor. Forte will play the lawyer hired off a billboard by Wile E. Coyote. Genius. To sue the Acme Corporation after so many mishaps involving Acme products, Cena plays Forte's former boss. Condor's role has yet to be disclosed. And of course, coming from Warner Brothers also, we've got Dune Part 2. We have some casting news, sources telling Deadline. They may have found Princess Irulan Carino, the eldest daughter of the Emperor, in talks with Florence Pugh for the role. No comment from anyone, of course. And also in talks, Austin Butler for the role of Fade Rautha, the sadistic nephew of Baron Harkonnen. This is the role that Sting played in the David Lynch movie, 1984. Of course, we don't have any comments anywhere from anyone. Production expected to begin this fall. And we will take a break and have more right after this.
Delivering the multiverse since 2009. This is Sci-Fi for Me TV.
I just can't imagine you reading racy adult material.
But you know what? You know what? I haven't. There's an author that I'm a big fan of. And he writes a science fiction series, and he writes a fantasy series, and he writes a smutty series. And the smutty series is really entertaining.
The H2O Podcast, Monday night at 8, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV. Thanks for watching Sci-Fi for Me TV. Be sure to connect with us on social media and subscribe to our channels so you don't miss our next broadcast. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
And hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us for the latest Star Wars news, which we call Salacious Crumbs. So StarWars.com has announced that tickets for Star Wars Celebration Anaheim 2022 will go back on sale to the general public on March 15th, 2022 at 12 p.m. Pacific time. Now, there's a limited amount of tickets left, and they will probably sell out fast. The announcement was also had a first look at some of the celebration merchandise, which includes honoring the 20th anniversary of Attack of the Clones. They will be available for pre-order to both new and existing ticket holders. Celebration's official Twitter account also revealed this official poster showing off characters from the years. This is the first celebration since Chicago in 2019, and it's going to be at the Anaheim Convention Center from May 26th to the 29th. So a couple other Twitter accounts popped up this week. We mentioned a couple weeks back that Anthony Daniels was working on a secret Star Wars project and speculated that it was for a droid story, the animated film revolving around droids, like our favorite too. This week, a Twitter account for a droid story has popped up. However, most think it's just a fake account. But what is real is the activation of the Obi-Wan Kenobi account. Their first tweet was the classic line from Attack of the Clones. And then it was followed by this week's Entertainment Weekly cover with Ewan McGregor as the Jedi and stills from the show. Oh, and did I mention that Phantom trailer finally dropped? It did, and we got to see McGregor in all of his Kenobi splendor, as well as Rupert Friend as the Grand Inquisitor, which he does look pretty good and is just about spot on from Rebels. Plus, several scenes with Moses Ingram looking pretty righteous as the Inquisitor chasing down, well, somebody. I could go on about the trailer, but if you want to know more about what Mr. Boss and I thought, then go check out our reaction video that we put out on Wednesday and let us know what you think. But I will leave you with some blue milk for thought. First, who do you think is holding that pistol in the alleyway? Some are saying that it looks a lot like Hans's pistol. Second, during the scene with the Grand Inquisitor, did you recognize that voice? And third, if Hayden Christensen is returning as Darth Vader and his mask is on, will James Earl Jones be voicing him? Now, according to a new report, it looks like The Bad Batch is not the only animated show Lucasfilm is working on. In an interview with The Convoy Call, Star Wars composer Kevin Kiner may have accidentally revealed that he's working on something other than season 2 music for The Bad Batch, saying, "It's a very special project, some great, great people are involved, and that it's kind of really, really freaking great, to the point where Lucasfilm and Disney are giving us full orchestra for every episode." Kiner composed the music for the Clone Wars movie in 2008, the Clone Wars series, and Rebels as well. So what else could be on his music stand? Well, there's been rumor that several voice actors have been recording for Lucas Animation, and among them was Sam Witwer, who was the voice of the animated Darth Maul. And the speculation has been that we might be getting something with the popular villain. Plus, if you notice, he's got a pretty good presence on that recently released Star Wars Celebration poster. However, though, late last year, StarWarsNews.net reported that Lucasfilm employee gifts featured logos for the upcoming shows and films, which included one for an unannounced series called Tales of the Jedi. This could represent the revival of the Dark Horse comic series set in the Old Republic, and it was with the other logos. So, at this point, is it going to be Maul or the Old Republic? And it was recently announced that Star Wars Legends Epic Collection, The New Republic Volume 6, would be released in September of this year. The omnibus will have Star Wars Crimson Empire and its sequels, Crimson Empire 2, Council of the Blood, and Crimson Empire 3, Empire Lost, plus material from Dark Horse Extra and Dark Horse Presents Number 1. As we get closer to the April 5th release of LEGO Star Wars The Skywalker Saga, we are seeing more of what players have in store. First, TT Games released a new video called Building the Galaxy, showing the level of detail they put into the various planets that will appear in the game. Not only are the various planets comparable to what we've seen on the big screen, but also you can see how different environments can affect the characters. For instance, on Tatooine, you can see grains of salt covering the character. And we'll put a link to that video in our show notes. LEGO also released more details on the different DLC packages that'll be available for the game. Warner Brothers revealed details to the Character Collection Season Pass, which features expansions for The Mandalorian, The Bad Batch, Rogue One, Solo, and more. These different packs will include characters from the different shows and movies. Two of these packs will be released on the game day's launch as part of the pass, as well as standalone purchases. The others will be released every few weeks. Ravensburger announced a new version of the popular Villainous game franchise called Star Wars Villainous: Power of the Dark Side. It'll feature 6 Star Wars villains, allowing players to choose between, like, Darth Vader, Assange Ventress, Kylo Ren, Moff Gideon, or General Grievous to battle for supremacy. It'll also include new twists to the game, including the introduction of vehicles. Each villain will have their own goals, and other players can interfere with them using the fate action, causing negative consequences to target another player. And like the Marvel villainous and Disney villainous games, this is intended to be a standalone and will most likely have an expansion pack of its own in the future if it is successful. The game will have a retail price of $29.99 and be released in August at most major retailers and hobby stores. As you might remember, the process to get the Kenobi series to this point has not been easy. Sure, there was the lockdown and pandemic, but there was also a pause for rewrites. This concerned many because we did see what happened with the solo project. In Entertainment Weekly's article, Lucasfilm president Kathleen Kennedy shared more insight on what happened. Originally, Hussein Amini was writing the series, but Lucasfilm felt the tone for his original plans did not translate well for television and for what the studio wanted. We're looking ultimately to make a hopeful, uplifting story, and it's tricky when we're starting with a character in the state that Obi-Wan would be coming off of in Revenge of the Sith. You can't just wave the magic wand with any writer and arrive at a story that necessarily reflects what you want to feel. Now, Lucasfilm learned the hard way with the solo project about trying to translate specific tones, changing directors midstream. So when they decided to bring on Joby Harold, he was aggressive about what should happen to the character, which seems to have worked for him. Director Deborah Chow admits they did use some of the original work, but made a lot of changes and added different elements. Deborah Chow and Kathleen Kennedy were also asked by Entertainment Weekly about the chances of Kenobi having a second season. They both stated that this was looked at as a limited series, with Chow pointing out that this was a big story with a beginning, a middle, and an end. Kennedy did say a reason to do a second season would be because the crew and actors had a great time doing it. However, why would they want to do more? They could continue with more Obi-Wan stories, but they would have to take a hard look at why they were actually doing it. Now, personally, I think this is a good question that Hollywood should try to answer more often. It sounds like they understand that the show cannot go on forever. And it also makes you wonder how much of that question is being asked for the Book of Boba Fett, as we wait to hear if they plan on continuing it or just blending it in with The Mandalorian. And Ewan McGregor, in an online interview with Entertainment Weekly, talks about the experience of getting back together with Hayden Christensen. And at one point in the video, he says, "I look over at him, and he's Anakin now. I'm Obi-Wan now. And it was like nothing had happened." Many are speculating this means we're probably going to get some live-action flashbacks to events that took place during the animated Clone Wars. And a few updates on the other shows. According to a new report from Making Star Wars, fans' favorite nanny is returning to The Mandalorian Season 3, IG-11. Yep, how? Not sure, since we saw him destroyed at the end of Season 1. But the thought is that the group of Jawas that we see at the end of the fight, before Moff Gideon emerges with the Darksaber, managed to salvage the droid, and this time he's been reinforced with some Beskar. Apparently, there's a spot in his chest that serves as a place for Grogu to sit and to control IG-11. Now, while this could be a completely different android, according to Making Star Wars' sources, the crew is calling it IG-11, and they are also expecting Taika Waititi will probably return as his voice. Making Star Wars also reports that during some filming for Season 3 in Long Beach, Din Djarin was fighting some red troopers and Praetorian guards who have weapons just like the ones in The Last Jedi. Making Star Wars believes that this may have to do with the cloning story arc and possibly even Snoke. And that's a name we have not heard in a while. So to support these rumors, this picture was provided. The Mandalorian Season 3 may have just gotten a little bit more interesting. Now, during an appearance on BBC's One's The One Show, Fiona Shaw was asked about her role in Andor. She didn't say much except reveal that her character pilots a large spaceship. She said, it was really something. It was so high to get into the spaceship, and it was tough to get in, and it wasn't what I thought it was going to be. Of course, the hosts did push for more details about what type of ship it was, but like any good Star Wars actor, she didn't give anything up. And what's this report over at Geekosity? Mike Sutton and Karen Bug filed a report back on March 4th that sources tell them The Mandalorian and Ahsoka are leading up to the very first movie made for Disney Plus, an adaptation to Heir to the Empire, Timothy Zahn's first book featuring Grand Admiral Thrawn, the book that kicked off the expanded universe, which is no longer canon. It would take a good bit of revision to fit the current Disney Star Wars, but Geekosity report says it's happening and that also Mara Jade may make an appearance. So this is an official rumor for now. And this week on Twitter, Mark Hamill confirmed extra filming for the extra scene in The Empire Strikes Back, months after principal photography had wrapped. When Twitter user at TSB Timeline inquired about the last scene of Empire, Hamill replied with this: filmed 4 months after we wrapped principal photography on ESB, it wasn't a reshoot, it was an added scene. Concerned about the downbeat ending and thorough defeat of the protagonists, they wanted to add an uplifting moment of hope and rejuvenation to reassure the audience. So apparently after being defeated, maimed, and finding out the bad guy was his father, George Lucas and director Irvin Kishner decided they needed to have a hopeful moment for the gang. Plus, it helped establish that the story wasn't over yet. This was just the end of the middle and that there was more to come. And that is all we've got this week for our Salacious Crumbs. Don't forget that we are on Facebook and Instagram, and make sure you hit that like button, and we will have more for you next week.
You're watching Sci-Fi for VTV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.
The beginning of the movie, she was pretty... But then over the course of the movie, I thought she became a little bit more...
But her character also becomes more numb. Because, I mean, she's just kind of like, I'll just run him over the car.
Well, I mean, killing people is hard.
Foreign Bodies, Saturday at 1 p.m. Eastern, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
But I think he just wanted silence on the topic. That's why the trades remain silent. Right. That's my opinion.
Well,
the Trays don't have the confirmation. The Trays don't have the confirmation. But her husband did it because he's trying to protect her and trying to encourage them to stick to that 3-year plan at the very least.
Yeah. I think you're right. I mean, so, and the very fact that the Trays don't have the confirmation, while this has now been globally widespread through secondary and tertiary sources, is a very bizarre thing.
Live from the bunker, only on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
You're watching Good Morning Multiverse, live on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
Back with more news, and this we've got here, the graphic novel, War Bears. This is a graphic novel written by Margaret Atwood, art by Ken Stacy. It's been optioned for animation adaptation by WoW Unlimited Media. The story is set during World War II about a young comic book artist who creates a popular title featuring a Nazi-fighting female bear warrior superheroine named Orsonette. This was published by Dark Horse Comics. It originally appeared as a short story in the Globe and Mail out in the UK, up in Canada, rather, celebrating Canada's 150th anniversary, with Stacy's illustrations combined with Atwood's words. Don't have a date on that as of yet. Amazon Prime Video is in talks for a God of War live-action TV adaptation. This is the Santa Monica Studio PlayStation game. The series will come from The Expanse creators Mark Fergus and Hawk Ostie and the Wheel of Time showrunner Rafe Judkins. God of War was created in 2005. Since then, has had 7 more games created across multiple platforms. Franchise focuses on Kratos' journey in the Greek world, following a path of vengeance as a result of being tricked into killing his family by the Olympian gods. Now that he lives outside the shadow of the gods, he must adapt to unfamiliar lands and threats and a second chance at being a father. So that's all that we've got as far as details on the adaptation at this time. But when we find out more, we will give that to you. Over on Kickstarter, Greenbrier Games is setting up to launch a campaign for its new adventure game, Fire for Light. It'll be for 1 to 4 players, a narrative-driven co-op game. There's a trailer. We will link to that so you can see what it's all about. And now on Kickstarter, a newly officially licensed campaign. Let me turn it on here. John Carter and John Carter, Warlord of Mars. Excuse me. This is based on Princess of Mars by Edgar Rice Burroughs. This is the first of the Barsoom novels featuring John Carter. And, of course, this comes on, I think, the 10th anniversary of the movie that we never got a sequel to. There's a story there. This is a first-person action game on PC, over 12 hours of single-player gameplay. The campaign ends April 4th. We'll have a link to this in our notes as well. And if you're waiting for the Halo Infinite campaign co-op expansion, you're going to be waiting for a while. Looks like another delay. This was expected with the second season May 3rd, but 343 Industries issued an update on things. Head of creative Joseph Staten writes on the blog that the non-linear wide open sections are presenting some challenges for split screen co-op play. They're hoping to release the feature later in the season. The new RPG Elden Ring, on its way to break some records, it's become the biggest Steam launch in the history of From Software. 600,000 players in the first hour is where it peaked, and according to a report from Steam Spy, it mayhaps have already sold over 10 million units for the PC in just a week. Now, these are based on estimates, not actual sales data, so that number could be off a bit, so it's not official, but a strong showing fresh out of the gate. And Frontier Developments have announced that they will not be going forward offering up new content for Elite Dangerous on console. That includes the Odyssey expansion. Instead, the company will focus on improving the PC edition. Following the problems after the rollout, the less-than-ideal launch of a major PC update last May, CEO David Braben says consoles will get only the critical updates. When Odyssey was released, there were a number of bugs, performance issues, game-breaking glitches, and Braben said they need the entire team focused on getting the PC version up to snuff. Video game developer Bungie has posted a new job opening. They're looking for a creative director to take on a new third-person action game. Someone to be the tip of the spear, they say, to drive the creative vision and bring the new game through all stages of development. We'll link to the listing in case you're interested in finding out more, because you never know. You could be the next creative director. On Thursday, Universal announced the first Super Nintendo World in the United States will open at Universal Studios Hollywood in 2023. Construction is currently underway. Another one will be placed at Universal Studios Orlando. This is an immersive experience in the world of Mario and Luigi and Princess Peach. This will be near the Transformers ride in the park, if you're familiar with the layout there. And just in case you're keeping track, the staff at Kotaku is back at Kotaku. The strike is over, which implies some sort of a deal is now in place. So for now, at least, the Gizmodo Media Group Union and Geo Media are playing nice. For now. So we'll see. Director Richard Linklater has posted a new trailer for his new project, Apollo 10.5, covering the Apollo 11 mission in the animated style he used for A Scanner Darkly. It stars Glenn Powell, Zachary Levi, Jack Black, and Josh Wiggins, and it will screen at South by Southwest on March 13th and then head over to Netflix. The story follows a kid named Stan, who's recruited by NASA for a top-secret mission to test the lunar lander by landing it on the moon. And the reason they have to recruit a kid is because the engineers built the lunar lander too small. We'll link to the trailer. Your tax dollars at work, right? Is that how it goes? More casting for Oppenheimer, speaking of. Josh Peck has joined the production. He'll play Kenneth Bainbridge, one of the scientists involved in the Manhattan Project. Another casting. Matthias Schweighofer is joining as well in an unknown role. So this is just filling out more A-list stars in the film about J. Robert Oppenheimer, the scientist who ran the Manhattan Project, of course, that developed the atomic bomb, coming out July 21st, 2023. And I would imagine that we have not seen the last or heard the last of that casting. We've got some casting for Quantum Leap. Ernie Hudson has joined the show as a co-lead opposite Raymond Lee, who's playing Dr. Ben Chong. Hudson will play Herbert Magic Williams, the head of the Time Travel Project, a Vietnam vet. With his military experience and network of political contacts, he manages to buy some time for the team to try to rescue Dr. Xiong, who's jumped into the Quantum Leap chamber and disappeared. And now he's stuck in the 1980s with amnesia. Three more names added to that cast. Caitlin Bassett, making her first television debut. Well, a debut would be the only television debut. After spending 7 years with U.S. Army Intelligence in the NSA, she was found through a talent scout program. She'll play Addison, a project lead running the tech to communicate with the time traveler. Nanrisa Lee joins as Jen, head of security for the project. And Mason Alexander Park, previously on Cowboy Bebop and coming up in The Sandman, will play Ian, the chief AI architect. So that appears to complete the main cast for the show. We still have no word yet about Scott Bakula's involvement, if any. There's that. The live-action One Piece has added 6 more to the cast. The announcement came on the 8th, along with this handy graphic, putting up names, faces, characters. Morgan Davies as Kobe. Alvida as Ilya Isarilis Polino. Hold on. Let me get this right. Morgan Davies is playing Kobe. Ilya Isarilis Polino is playing Alvida. I had it backwards on my script. McKinley Belcher as Arlong. Jeff Ward as Buggy. Vincent Reagan as Garp. And Aiden Scott as Helmeppo. Physically, it looks like they all pretty much fit the characters that they're supposed to be playing. So there is that. All right. New from Dark Horse Comics. Massive. This is a breakout written by Zach Kaplan with art by Wilton Santos. Massive cube spaceships from another dimension arrive at Earth, and they are abducting teenagers. After his brother is taken, Liam assembles a team of ordinary high school students to risk everything to save the people who are held prisoner, because the government and the adults have just decided this is the thing we're going to have to deal with. They've yielded to the inevitable. Jim Campbell on letters, Jason Wardle on Wardy on colors. This is on shelves April 13th. And speaking of cube spaceships, let's have some Triple Bytes. On Tuesday, actress Jeri Ryan posted on social media they have a series wrap on Picard, meaning that they have completed principal photography on the third and final season, just as season two starts rolling out on Paramount Plus. She says she can't wait for people to see what happens in season three. And Trek Central reports via Twitter that Star Trek Discovery is currently filming for season five. They spotted this entry here. Let me see if I got it. I didn't have it. They've spotted an entry in the Directors Guild of Canada production listing. They have shooting that runs from June to November, according to the entry. Gives us a likely premiere sometime mid to late 2023. And on the same day that we get the teaser for Obi-Wan Kenobi, we also got the teaser for Strange New Worlds. Now, personally, I think somebody in marketing at Paramount Plus needs to rethink a few things. I mean, really. The day of the Disney investors call, the day that the cancel mob is going after Disney over Florida and China, the day that they release the Kenobi trailer, you give us the Strange New Worlds trailer. Okay. Anyway. Well, we get in this, we see Tango. It appears Pike gets called back into uniform, possibly out of retirement, which is somewhat consistent with his ruminations from the cage. We also see Spock overlooking a city that may be Sikar. We've got a new planet, new people, not much else to give away plot points. The show debuts on May 5th. What?
Oh, nothing.
Oh. All right. New models from Eagle Moss available for pre-order now, part of their XL Starships collection. The USS Stargazer, as it appeared in Star Trek The Next Generation. Hand-painted, 9 1/4 inches long. This is an update from the die-cast model originally released in 2014. This new edition goes for $55. And the Caretaker's Array from the pilot episode of Voyager, 9 inches tall with all the angled sprues around the central hub of the station. This will run you $75. And then we have this Hierarchy Assault Ship. This is a deep cut from the Voyager episodes Tinker, Tenor, Dr. Spy, and The Void, used by the Hierarchy Onlookers as observation craft. It's 3 1/2 inches. It goes for $35. Eagle Moss is also going to be launching figures. Official statuettes collection, 8-inch character figures, starting with Lieutenant Spock, as portrayed by Ethan Peck in Discovery Season 2. No price has been announced for this figure yet. It's available for pre-order soon, they say. And XO6 has announced their new 1/6 scale replica, Captain Picard's command chair from First Contact. The accessory is made for the figures that are already out there, so you can sit Captain Picard in his chair. It's got integrated USB-powered lighting and sound functions. They're also working on a display background, a backdrop that's sold separately, that can put everybody on the bridge of the Enterprise E. The chair is expected for delivery in August. It can be pre-ordered now for $195. And finally, our condolences to the family and friends of Laurel Goodwin, the last remaining original crew member of the Starship Enterprise. She played Yeoman Colt in the original pilot, The Cage. This came 4 years after her acting debut opposite Elvis Presley in Girls, Girls, Girls. And beside her acting career, she also had a producer credit. She and her husband, Hank Moonjean, produced the Burt Reynolds movie Stroker Ace in 1983. Goodwin is survived by her sister. No cause of death was reported. She was 79. And those are your Tribble Bytes for this week. Don't forget to subscribe and share the video with your fellow fans. Connect with us on social media. We will have more as it comes in to us.
Delivering the multiverse since 2009. This is Sci-Fi for Me TV. Sci-Fi for Me is about to take you on an incredible journey into the realms of science fiction, fantasy, and horror. Interviews with writers, filmmakers, artists, and actors. conventions and fandom, previews and reviews of movies and television. Sci-Fi for Me is working to be the most popular science fiction magazine in the solar system. Subscribe now and enter the fantastic world of Sci-Fi for Me, delivering the multiverse since 2009. You're watching Good Morning Multiverse, live on Sci-Fi for Me TV.
All right. Screen Geek is reporting that they've confirmed Anson Mount will reprise his role as the Inhuman Black Bolt in Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness. We've heard rumors about this for a while. First introduced on the ABC television show that fared poorly in the ratings, Black Bolt's the leader of the Inhumans, along with his wife Medusa. And that lines up, given what we've seen in the latest trailer, the suggestion and speculation that the Illuminati would be in the film. Black Bolt is among that group. We'll find out for sure when the film hits theaters on May the 6th. And we have some new images from Moon Knight. There they are. Featuring Oscar Isaac in three different iterations of his character. Maybe we could say three of his characters. This is out March 30th on Disney Plus. And Eric Davis is reporting that Spider-Man No Way Home will be hitting Vudu iTunes Digital on March 15th, a full week earlier than originally scheduled. It'll also be available wherever you buy your digital copies. This comes after a full HD copy surfaced on the high seas over the last week. So, there's that. By the way, in Russia, they're not going to stop you from singing Yo-Ho-Ho, apparently. Not that I'm advocating for that. I'm not. Don't do it. It appears Kraven the Hunter has found its main villain. Sources are stating that Christopher Abbott is set to join the movie as the Foreigner, one of Spider-Man's bigger adversaries. The character has been a major part in the Spider-Man comic over the years. No superhuman abilities, however, this mercenary assassin is one of the more trained martial artists in Marvel Comics. Sony had no comment, of course, because that would just make things too easy. Sean Levy looking to team up again with Ryan Reynolds for round three. He's currently in negotiations to direct Deadpool 3 with Paul Wernick writing the script. And this is somewhat of a surprise for some people, thinking that Levy's sensibilities and tone might not match Deadpool. But Ryan Reynolds is the guy who came up with the idea that Levy should direct Deadpool 3. So Deadpool thinks that Levy should be directing Deadpool. Their current project, The Atom Project, is out this weekend on Netflix. They've worked together as well on Free Guy, which also has a sequel in development. Now, we've got our first look possibly at maybe what Tatiana Maslany may look like as She-Hulk. It's because of a thermos leak. No, that's not a pun. Thermos, actually, this was out. These images popped up, giving us a look at a merch tie-in with Thermos, showing us Maslany in costume, in makeup, full She-Hulk. Looks almost comics accurate. Not sure where this first surfaced, but it appears to have been sourced from a now-deleted product listing on Amazon. Somebody saw it, and it started circulating, so we're not sure who saw it first. But this is what they saw. This could be concept art, but it does give us an idea, at least, of what the character will look like, possibly. Director Ryan Coogler running into some trouble in Atlanta this week. He went into a Bank of America wearing sunglasses and a mask to withdraw $12,000, passing a note to be discreet. He also gave the account number. And apparently it's to pay somebody who does not like to get checks. Now, the amount of the withdrawal triggered an alert. And the way it was done, and the two friends in the SUV outside, the teller had a little moment of panic. And they thought that Coogler was trying to rob the bank. He was detained. They cleared it up fairly quickly. Coogler says it never should have happened, but the bank addressed it to his satisfaction, and everyone has moved on. Coogler is currently in Atlanta to direct Black Panther 2. And we've got a first look from Peter Pan and Wendy for Peter Pan. And we've got a look at Captain Hook. This is Alexander Maloney as Peter, Jude Law as Captain Hook. These pictures soon started making the rounds on the internet, coming out of the Walt Disney Company shareholder meeting on Wednesday. Ever Anderson plays Wendy. Alan Tudyk and Molly Parker are Mr. and Mrs. Darling. David Lowery is directing. This will be out sometime this year. And some new details on the upcoming Doctor Who special episode, Legend of the Sea Devils, finding their way to us through Doctor Who magazine. Executive producer Matt Strevens says it's a bit of a swashbuckler, and it's also the last regular story before the show goes into the arc leading to the Doctor's regeneration. Chris Chibnall co-writing with Olivier-nominated playwright Ella Rode. This is her debut for the show. Also, the first time a guest writer, somebody not on the writing staff, is helping to write a special. And we've already had confirmation of the long-simmering rumor that Haolu Wang is directing. We also have word now that Craig Ells returns to the cast, this time listed as Narcissus. Some are speculating that it's the lead Sea Devil that we see here. Streven says this was a chance for all the design departments to show off. With three full-size galleon ships in the studio, exquisite costumes, this special will air in the spring. And those of us of an age will recognize the name Conrad Jenis. Star of stage and screen, on the radar for many of us because of his role as dad to Pam Dauber's Mindy on the sitcom Mork and Mindy. His business manager confirmed to the New York Times that Jenis passed away on March 1st in Los Angeles. He was a jazz trombonist, actor. Later, he and his brother took over the Sidney Jenis Gallery from their father, who founded the art collection. He's survived by his son, daughter, brother, and extended family. He was 94. Our condolences to his family and friends. And we're going to get another Muppet movie. Another Muppet series, actually. On March 7th, Disney announced plans for a new Muppet show. This one focused on Dr. Teeth and the Electric Mayhem, titled The Muppets Mayhem. The show will co-star Lily Singh. And this one comes from Adam Goldberg of The Goldbergs. Along with Dr. Teeth puppeteer Bill Beretta and Jeff Yokes, the show will follow the Muppets house band as they attempt to record their first official album with advice from A&R executive Nora, played by Singh. She's very excited about it. She's been posting about it over on Instagram. Executive producer David Lightbody says they're excited to bring the band front and center. This will go to Disney Plus, but there's no date yet. And finally, since we're talking about Muppets, our condolences also to the family of actor Emilio Delgado. He had a long career in front of the camera, but he's likely best known to all of us as Luis, the owner of the Fix-It Shop on Sesame Street. He joined the show in the third season all the way back in 1971 and stayed with the show until 2016, holding the record for the longest running role for a Mexican-American in a television series. His character was also instrumental when Sesame Street decided to explore the idea of love and marriage, Luis and Maria getting married on the show. And for a long time after, whenever he was seen in public with his real wife, there were questions. Delgado passed away Thursday after battling cancer. His wife, Carol, confirmed the news to the Associated Press. He was 81, and he will be missed by many, I'm sure. All right, that's going to do it for us today, folks. Thank you very much for being here. I apologize for the glitches, the different buttons that I hit that I shouldn't have hit, and the buttons I didn't hit that I should have hit. every now and again we have one of those days here, right? Okay. So if you are new to the channel, we do invite you to subscribe and have your notifications turned on. Let me look and see where is... There it is. All right. If you'd like to find us over on social media, we're on 12 different platforms. We're on 4 video platforms. We do have a newsletter that you can sign up for. And if you are inclined to throw a little coin our way, we've got a PayPal link and a Subscribestar account as well. So certainly no obligation, but all of your support just by being here, sharing links, giving us your feedback, all of that is much appreciated. And that's going to do it for us today. We will be back to do this all again next week. Have a good weekend, everybody.
Copyright 2022 by Flaming Dog Media, LLC. All rights reserved. No portion of this program may be retransmitted without the express written consent of Flaming Dog Media. You're watching Sci-Fi for Me TV, delivering the multiverse since 2009.